Can you see both the presentation and the visualizer? Okay. So we have already considered several representations of the Heisenberg group, and for a representation of Heisenberg group, we introduced the wavelet transform. So wavelet transform was defined by means of a pairing for translated mother wavelet V naught with given signal V. So this is a general formula which can be applied to any representation of any group with bigger or smaller usefulness. But for Heisenberg group, it's extremely useful. And one of the way to make it even more explicit and even more transparent would be just to modify slightly the formula for the wavelet transform. And this formula can be translated to the form which is known as Fourier-Wigner transform. So again, just according to the definition, wavelet transform given by such an expression, and we substitute the Schrödinger representation for rho h here, and make some adjustment. In particular, we want to make a change of variable such that we have here the Fourier transform with respect to variable x double dash, and in arguments of function f and function phi, which is used as mother wavelets, they are shifted by the same amount, but in the opposite direction, plus half of x and minus half of x. So the name Fourier-Wigner transform came from the fact what if we will apply further to this transformation, usual Fourier transform in two variables, x and y, then result will be exactly Wigner transform introduced in quantum mechanics. Wigner transform in quantum mechanics connect the classical transformation on the phase space with corresponding operators on the quantum observables. So we will not dig much into Wigner transform in this course, but it's really a helpful tool in quantum mechanics. Instead, we will just use Fourier-Wigner transform to derive some properties of wavelet transform for the Heisenberg group. So it's easy to see that actually Fourier-Wigner transform is a composition of two transformation which preserve the measure. One transformation is a change of variable, so this is what we applied on the functions. And a second one is the partial Fourier transform. Fourier transform which send x double dash to y. So both transformations being unitary operators on L2R2. So here we consider the product of two functions f and phi bar as the element of the tensor product. So it's a tensor product of L2 over R with itself, so which can be associated with L2 over R squared. And so this transformation being unitary on this space allow us to derive some important properties of the wavelet transform for the Heisenberg group. So properties are as follow. So if we will compare with discussion on the previous slide. Easy to see what tensor product of the Schwarz space function, smooth, rapidly decreasing at infinity function, is transformed again to the smooth, rapidly decreasing functions. This is the property of the Fourier transform, which is responsible to that. And also, it's a unitary transformation on the corresponding L2 spaces. Furthermore, having that unitarity of our transformation, we may derive very important formula, which will be very helpful in the several occasions later, what inner product between two wavelet transform of two signals, F1 and F2, with respect to maybe different mother wavelets, phi1 and phi2, is completely determined by the inner product of signals between themselves and inner product between mother wavelets. So in particular, if we will make Fourier transform we will do wavelet transform with respect to different mother wavelets which are orthogonal each other, then images of this Fourier transform will be orthogonal regardless of which signals are used. So that formula is really crucial, and it's preserved orthogonality of the spaces, and it's summarized, that formula can be also summarized by saying what Schrödinger representation is square integrable with modulus the center of the Heisenberg group. Square integrability of representation means here what the wavelet transform of L2 function will be L2 function on corresponding homogeneous space with respect to invariant measure on this homogeneous space. In particular, for Fock-Siegel-Bargmann transform, which we considered before on several occasions. So Fock-Siegel-Bargmann transform, which is a transformation based on the Gaussian. So this transformation is a unitary operator from the L2 on the real line to L2 space on the plane. And of course, it's occupy not entire L2 over plane, but just some subspace with nice important properties. So coming further, we will derive the connection between the wavelet transform and inverse wavelet transform. So using that relation, orthogonality relation, which we already stated, we can derive the formula for reconstructing of a signal from its wavelet transform. So we apply to a signal wavelet transform with the mother wavelet phi, and we use reconstructing formula contravariant transform with the mother wavelet psi. So result will be the initial signal f multiplied by a fixed coefficient, which is again just the inner product of analyzing and reconstructing mother wavelets phi and psi. So in particular, if we will take this analyzing and reconstructing vectors to be orthogonal, then that will be just a zero operator. So nothing useful will come out. So we shall avoid taking orthogonal mother wavelets for analyzing and reconstructing. So how to demonstrate that formula? So let us take an inner product of that composition of contravariant and covariant transform with an arbitrary function G on the real line. So just substituting the definition, what does it mean to make a reconstruction with the vector psi? That means reconstruction is given as integrated representation with the wavelet transform being the function which is used for that integrated representation. When assuming what our functions are nice, for example, if we are taking the Schwarz space functions here to change the order, exchange the order of inner product and integration, we place inner product inside of the integral. Then, of course, according to the definition, that is just the wavelet transform of a function G with mother wavelet psi. But for inner product of two such transformations, we have a formula which we can apply here. So we will just get F and G times the coefficient. So comparing the left-hand side of our expression and right-hand side of our expression, taking into account what G here is an arbitrary L2 function. So rather, we are applying arbitrary bounded linear function on the Hilbert space here for this identity. We obtain the result. Next important consequence of the formula 83 is the property related to the twisted convolution. So probably it will be good to remind what is twisted convolution at this point. So when we consider it, the lifting of our function from homogeneous space to a group, and then take the integrated representation of the lifted function, when we observed what the composition of two integrated representation would be a result in the integrated representation with certain operation on function phi1 and phi2, f1 and f2. And that formula, again, has a rather general nature. It's not only for the Heisenberg group, but we may apply it for the Heisenberg group explicitly, and we will obtain what is called a twisted convolution. So it looks like we have a normal convolution for function k1 and k2. So normal convolution is given by such an integral, but there is here also a twist. We have exponential term from the imaginary unit times the symplectic form. So this is unimodular factor here, which depend on the symplectic form. And when we integrate, so it gives some oscillating, twisting elements here, which produce a different, from ordinary convolution, a different value. So this is the twisted convolution as we define it on the Heisenberg group. So let us see our statement about twisted convolution. So it's told what if we consider a twisted convolution of two wavelet transform, again, different signals and different analyzing vectors, mother wavelets, phi1 and phi2 are used here. Result will be mother wavelet. Here we take, as you can see, the cross wavelet transform signal F taken from the F1, from the first wavelet transform, but analyzing vector is from the second wavelet transform, phi2, and a constant factor, which is, again, inner product. So let us see why this happened. So just from the definition of the wavelet transform, which we will denote here by F capital, and the integrated representation of the twisted convolution, we will apply again to arbitrary function g from L2. So using the definition of the, or defining property of the twisted convolution, that twisted convolution can be split into two integrated representation for F1 and F2. When using the relation for the integrated representation, we actually here are making a reconstructing of the signal using G as reconstructing vector, and then the to the applied to the wavelet transform, which is given by F2 capital. But for such a composition, we have a formula. For such composition, we have a formula here, which provide us with just the product of F2 with some constant factor, G times phi2 in a product. Here, this is a constant factor. We can put by linearity it outside, and then just repeat the same steps once more for the integrated representation of F1 applied to F2. This is again a reconstruction of the corresponding wavelet transform with F2 as the reconstructing vector, using with the previous argument second time, formula 84, we get what we obtain F1 back with the constant factor. But for F1 times the constant factor G phi 2, we may use the formula 84 in the opposite direction. We can write it down as the reconstructing of the wavelet transform, and that will produce for us just integrated representation of this wavelet transform applied to the function g. So applying to a function g on the right hand side some operator, we received function g acted by some other operator on the left hand right hand side. So because that happened for arbitrary function g, operators on the left hand side and right hand side shall be equal, and we get the identity for the corresponding twisted convolution. So this is the proof, which link together again a very important formula, which explain quite a lot of calculations, which typically done in the theory of pseudo-differential operators or in the case of the quantum mechanics. So that general formulas for twisted convolutions and analysis and analyzing and reconstructing formulas of covariant and contravariant transform has especially simple expressions if we apply them to the Gaussian, our functions most suitable for being a mother wavelet or a ground coherent states, vacuum state in quantum mechanics. So we put phi small to be Gaussian of this type. So there is here a factor root of order 4 from 2. It's normalizing factor to make it a unit norm. So some other possibility of normalization is take exponent of minus pi x squared divided by 2 when factor with 4th roots of 2 is not necessary to normalize, but we will need to carry out that division by 2 and exponent always, so it's somehow again not it's a choice of convenience what we shall take one way or another. So phi capital will be the transformation, wavelet transform of the Gaussian, where mother wavelet is Gaussian again. So it's with type of transformation, and phi AB is just shifted wavelet transform of the Gaussian. So we apply a left shift on the Heisenberg group with parameters AB to that phi capital. Well, it's easier to verify the following properties. First of all, explicitly, wavelet transform, if we will use expression for the Fourier transform of the Gaussian, will produce this formula. So phi capital is just like Gaussian of in two dimensions. So that is our expression. Correspondingly, the shifted Gaussian, if we apply left shift, is just the formula which we have on the Heisenberg group. So we have shift in A and B in corresponding components. And there is this term which appears from the symplectic form, just by nature of left shift on corresponding space of functions. Now, useful formula will be if we will take integrated representation of the Gaussian and put a representation rho in between with parameters AB. So that will be just a product of two Gaussians, so integrated representation for the Gaussian and the factor which is just Gaussian at point AB. That is actually follow from previous proposition, because if you will compare what the third formula is telling, that is symbolically means what we have a twisted convolution of the shifted of Gaussian, transformed Gaussian with the shifted transformed Gaussian. So formula 3 and 4 are essentially the same. And then from the previous property, we just immediately verify what we have such an expression for with twisted convolution. And here that factor which we have on top, that is according to the first formula, is phi capital itself. So that is just direct consequences from our calculations. And now we have at hand everything what we need to prove Stone von Neumann theorem. So I recall what we have constructed several different representations of the Heisenberg group, or at least several different forms of representations of the Heisenberg group. It was representation on the real line, on the plane, so Fox-Siegel-Bargmann representation, and we get a representation which is obtained by induction from a discrete subgroup. It's a representation on a torus related to the theta function. So all these different representations have different expressions, and a question is what are essentially different type of representation for the Heisenberg group, in the sense what we are not unitary equivalent, we are not intertwined by some unitary operator. And meaning of this theorem it became even more crucial not it's not only an element of representation theory, it was historically a very important theorem in the 30s at the beginning of the quantum theory. That theorem clarify a connection between the Schrödinger equation and Heisenberg matrix mechanics. So maybe I briefly recall the history. So at the beginning of 20th century, some phenomena was observed on the level of atoms, on quantum level, which cannot be explained in term of classical mechanics. In particular, certain system had discrete spectrum rather than having a continuous spectrum as it would be follow from the theory of classical Newtonian mechanics. And in order to build an explanation, a model for that quantum effects, mainly for discreteness, existence of quantas of energy and quantas of other quantities, was done several attempts, and two particularly successful was Heisenberg matrix mechanics. Heisenberg introduced a model where he represent coordinates and momentum of a physical system as certain infinite dimensional matrices, and in terms of these matrices he was able to reproduce observed experiments and was able to give consistent replacement for quantum for classical mechanics. On the other hand, the Schrödinger produced another model which looked completely different. So instead of these infinite dimensional matrices, he just considered certain second order differential operator on the real line, the equation which we now know as the Schrödinger equation, and then spectrum of this second order differential operator also reproduce the discreteness, so was a suitable model. And at the beginning, so these two different mathematical setup giving the same desired models look like a mystery, or why we produce both models for the same system being mathematically very different. And people also was wondering, so it was rather good agreement in many respects between two models. They predict the same effects based from different mathematics, and but question remain where will be all where predictions the same, or it may be what some prediction coincide, but after elaborating theories further it will come some certain disagreement between Heisenberg matrix mechanics and Schrödinger equation. And that all question with questions of this type was resolved once the Stone-Von-Neumann theorem was demonstrated. And essentially this theorem told what both infinite dimensional matrices of Heisenberg and operators of derivative and multiplication which are used to build the Schrödinger equation, they are both provide representation for canonical commutator relation. So I recall canonical commutator relation, this is our very elementary first steps in the theory of the Heisenberg group. So when commutator of coordinate and momentum is given the identity times Planck constant. So, and that commutators really define the Lie algebra of the Heisenberg group, and so both matrix mechanics and Schrödinger equation are representing Heisenberg-Lie group. And if we will follow the Stone-Von-Neumann theorem, that theorem tells what this representation are unitary equivalent. So it's possible to find, and it's actually easy to, it's now it's straightforward, to write down explicitly that unitary operator which intertwine two models, Schrödinger and Heisenberg, and correspondingly all predictions which you can get or all conclusions which you derive from one model can be straightforwardly derived also from another model. So these models, being mathematically or looking initially rather different, are actually essentially the same just because they are given representation of the Heisenberg group. So let us see how the Strong-Neumann theorem can be proven. So here is its accurate statement. Essentially, it's told us what if we have a representation where the center is represented by a character. So in other words, representation can be induced from this character. Then the representation can be decomposed into the direct sum of irreducible representations. So that representation is a direct sum of irreducible representation, and each irreducible representation, if we will restrict a given representation to irreducible subspace, is equivalent to the Schrödinger representation, or again to the Fock-Siegel-Bargmann representation as well, because it's just unitary equivalent model. So let us see how that can be demonstrated. Just before we will go into the proof, the idea is what given arbitrary representation of the Heisenberg group, we are looking for inside of this space of representing space, something which corresponds to the Gaussian, to the vacuum state, to the vacuum state of the harmonic oscillator. And once we identify the vector corresponding to the Gaussian, the rest can be immediately recovered by the structure of the Heisenberg group. So it's easy to show using the Fourier inversion what if we will for given unitary representation of the Heisenberg group pass to its integrated representation, that would be injective map of L1. So we shall not worry about a kernel of such representation. When we pick up, as in previous statement, our function phi Gaussian and its wavelet transform related to our representation rho and shifted Gaussian, when from the previous formulas, again, just as we said it before, we are able to demonstrate that formula 89. And that formula 89, actually for A and B being equal to zero, tell us what integrated representation of the Gaussian behave like a projection. So square of this operator is equal to this operator again. So if you substitute to this formula A and B equal to zero, you get that conclusion. Further, we will see what, because function phi is even and real, that integrated representation of phi will be self-adjoint. So this reduced to orthogonal projection. So this is an orthogonal projection. Now, we are looking to the R, what is the range of that orthogonal projection. So essentially, everything in this space R is can be taken as the image of the Gaussian. So that is the idea, what any vector from the space R may serve as the ground state for our representation. What we will demonstrate now, what for two vectors being in this range of the projection rho phi, the inner product between them will be preserved by our representation. So if we apply a representation rho with some parameters a, b to u, and rho with some parameter c, d to v, then inner product will be the same as inner product u and v with some factor. So demonstration is rather straightforward. We just use here unitarity of our representation, so that part CD and rho phi from the right hand side of inner product can be transferred to the left hand side. And here for that expression here of integrated representation, we once more use the formula 88 to get what we essentially have here, just rho of phi, but rho of phi applied to a function u in the range of this projection will be just u again. So in particular, if we that formula tell us if u and v are initially orthogonal, then anywhere transformations by representation rho will be orthogonal again. That means we obtain orthogonal decomposition. So taking any basis of vector space R, this is a Hilbert space, so a subspace of Hilbert space, closed one, so we can pick up an orthonormal basis for this subspace. And then considering spaces H alpha spanned by this orthonormal basis. So clearly that provide the corresponding decomposition of our Hilbert space into a direct sum of irreducible components. Why each component, restriction to each component, we obtain a representation which is equivalent to the Schrodinger one, that can be demonstrated using just Waverley transform or by the intertwining operator between representation rho applied to that basic vector V alpha, which span our space, translation which spans to the space, with the translation of the Gaussian. So using Gaussian as the reference vector for our space, we are able to establish such a correspondence. So Waverley transform is just another way to establish such a unitary operator between two space. So this is the proof of Stone von Neumann theorem. So we are now can deduce what the all various representation which was constructed in our course with the same character of the center, with the same Planck constant h bar, are unitary equivalent. But practical practically it's still an advantage to have different form of the same representation, even although they are equivalent. So in particular, that representation which was induced from the discrete subgroup, although it's equivalent to the Schrodinger representation and Fock-Siegel-Bargmann representation, it has its own advantages. So in question of number theory leading to theta function, that representation just cannot be substituted by anything else. And similarly, again, if we will compare the Schrodinger representation and Fock-Siegel-Bargmann representation, which again by the Stone von Neumann theorem are equivalent, each space has own advantages. The Schrodinger representation is good for the reason that L2 space, the entire space L2, is irreducible. So Schrödinger representation is irreducible, this is its advantage. But Fock-Siegel-Bargmann representation, where we need to restrict our attention from entire L2 space to proper subspace, subspace of analytical function, has just an advantage what elements of with vector space are analytic functions, so we can use quite a lot of material from complex analysis about analytical function in a study of this space. So it's really useful to have all these different models in our hands and just swing from one to another at suitable occasions using advantages of particular realization of the equivalent representations. Since we already spoke about Gaussian and harmonic oscillator, it's worth to formalize what we did, because again, it leads to some important part of mathematics. So we take our commutators on the Lie algebra, Weyl algebra of the Heisenberg group. So we have vector space X and Y, and we build, so that is normally considered as a real Lie algebra, but we may formally at least produce the linear combination with the complex coefficients, so I, and that will be operator of creation and annihilation, or ladder operator with plus or minus and minuses. Just using the standard commutator relation between X and Y, we may expand here the commutator with this complex coefficient and find out what we obtain the central element S with a factor I over 2. So in particular, if we will go to a Schrödinger representation, that value of commutator will be a multiple of identity. Here, factor is a real one. If we look on commutators of representation of vector field X and Y, commutator will be I times identity. Here we have pi. And we already have Gaussian, which is annihilated by the linear combination X plus IY. So this is what we already had and discussed before. Now let us take out the collection of vectors where we apply powers M of a creation operator A plus to the ground states. So in physical terms, we obtain just first excited state of the quantum system, second excited state, and so on, out of the ground states. So when just out of general theory, operator of creation and annihilation are adjoined each other. So because our representation is unitary, using unitarity of our representation, it's easy to demonstrate what this operator became adjoint one of another. When it's again easy to verify what annihilation operator applied to U sub M will give the previous element U sub M minus one with certain factor. So that follow from just composition of these operators, annihilation applied to the created by induction from this formula. UM is created from UM minus one by creation operator, but that is just applied if we will use commutator relation with the following term. And here this is just a step of inductive proof, so mathematical induction based on this calculation, give our statement. Next important property which follow from the adjointness of our property of what creation operator is adjoint to annihilation operator, we may observe what functions on and om are orthogonal if n and m are different. So, for example, assuming what n is smaller than m, we replace this function in the inner product by their definition in terms of creation operators. When the bigger power m can be transferred by adjoint operator to the from the right to left, so that will be m power of the annihilation operator. But we are applying here the higher power of annihilation, power bigger than power of creation operator applied to the vacuum state. So by the previous property, after we m exceed n, so that produce zero. So that by previous property, it will be equal to zero. So when we may define the Hermite function as properly normalized our function OM, so we just normalize them to be orthonormal, and then it's turn out what our creation and annihilation operator are acting by shift on the indices. So annihilation operator decrease index of functions by one, and creation operator increase index of function by one. So this is the properties which we have. So composition of creation and annihilation in one way or another leave of function phi m in place with certain factor. Probably it's even more straightforward to see ladder operators in the Fock-Siegel-Bargmann model. This is what I told you before, what it's useful to have all various form of our representations which we have. So just to finish with previous slide, so what we obtained here, Hermite functions, that they are just very important special orthogonal function on the real line. So this is part of the big theory of orthogonal polynomials, special functions, which are helpful in solution of certain suitable problems. So, but when we consider a creation and annihilation operator, ladder operator on Fock-Siegel-Bargmann model, when instead of Hermite function, we just get even simpler expression. We get the powers of monomial, so just the same arguments as before, produce what we have a powers of monomials multiplied by the corresponding measure, which is Gaussian measure on this line. And name, again, just visualize action of with ladder operators, explaining why they are useful here. So we have ground states phi naught, and then we just get creation operator making the chain of all other functions, and annihilation operator acting in opposite direction, so decreasing index. So we have a ladder of eigenfunction here. And just applying that finally to the Hermite operator, which is in term of ladder operator given by such an expression, that is also Hamiltonian of harmonic oscillator. And conclusion which we derive from previous calculations in physical terms may be stated as the spectrum of the harmonic oscillator is discrete. Eigenfunctions which we have here for ladder operators. So that will be that function phi m will be eigenfunction for the harmonic oscillator, and it's easy to see what applying the creation operator to an eigenfunction with eigenvalue k just produce with the value 2k plus 1 produce an eigenfunction with eigenvalues increased by 2. So just based on previous commutators and expressions, we get that calculation which shows what we get eigenfunction with eigenvalue 2k plus 3. And if we will look on the dynamic of the harmonic oscillator on the Fock-Siegel-Bargmann space, then it will be just a rotation of the corresponding variable. So we get some simple graphical presentation how harmonic oscillator acting on the corresponding functions and variables in Fock-Siegel-Bargmann case. Okay, so it's a good place to stop our lecture today. Questions? Okay, thank you.